We have come over a way that with tears have been watered.
Yes.
We have come treading a path through the blood of the slaughtered.
Yes.
It's been a long and a hard struggle, and it's a struggle that still continues.
Yes.
It was for that reason, 3, maybe 4 years ago, the Bethany Baptist Church Book Club thought it's not enough that we are reading and becoming enlightened and becoming educated and learning about our history. But one of the goals of the club is dissemination and to share. And we decided at that point that we needed to get the entire church reading and the entire church on the path of education. And because of that, we declared that, I think that was the year 2012, that it would be the year of Claudette Colvin, and that we would use her book as a challenge to the entire church to read about this young woman and the magnificent work and the courageous thing that she did. I guess it's 59 years ago. So we're very honored to have her here. But I'm not the person who's going to introduce her. Mr. Hamm is going to do that, but I just had to tell her how grateful we are for her courage, for her strength, and for the love that she obviously has had for her people. So we thank you. And I mean it from the bottom of my heart. We stand on the shoulders of strong men and women like her, and it's an honor to be in her presence. But it's also an honor to be with all of you, because obviously you have that same drive and that same commitment towards the uplift of your people. And by your people, I mean all of humankind, but especially all those who have been tromped on, who have been oppressed, who have been disenfranchised. And we have to be vigilant. It's not enough that we live in a warm house and have 3 good meals a day, and obviously I have a few more than that. That's not enough. But we have to make sure that every man, woman, and child has that same opportunity. And it's because of people like Ms. Colvin that we are in the position that we are in. And I'm glad to see you here, because that means that you are grateful for her work as well. So thank you for coming. And I'm gonna sit down, because I could stay up here all day, but I won't. And I'm gonna bring to the podium Mr. Hamm, who is the motivational, spiritual, political, social leader of the People's Organization for Progress, and a good friend of Bethany Baptist Church. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Power to the people. I'm very glad and very honored to be here and to have the opportunity to introduce our guest speaker for today. And I was sitting and reflecting on her contribution to the African American freedom struggle. And I had to go back in time a little bit and think about my own upbringing. You know, in the black community, there was a tradition of sending kids down south for the summer. And especially bad kids. And I was one of those kids that got sent down south for the summer. My family's origins go to Gainesville, Georgia. Yes, indeed, Gainesville, Georgia. It's outside of Atlanta. And there's a train, if you go to Penn Station, Newark today, and you stand in the waiting area and you look up at the big board that has all the trains on it, you'll see where they list the names of a train called the Silver Meteor. Now, the Silver Meteor has significance for many of us because many of our folk came up on the Silver Meteor. The Silver Meteor runs from Florida to Maine. And many of our folks, you know, they were trying to get to New York and they heard the conductor say, "Newark," and they thought it was New York. And they got off in Newark. But seriously, In the late 50s and 60s, my family would go down south. And I remember 1961, my mother's sister, Gladys, my mother, my grandmother's sister, Joan, and myself, we got on the train at Penn Station in Newark. And everything was fine. You know, it's exciting to go on a trip by train. But then something funny happened when we got to Washington, D.C., the nation's capital, the citadel of democracy. Something happened. The conductor came and told us that we had to move to the rear of the train. Now, this was in Washington, D.C. Now, why did this happen in Washington, D.C.? Because, as one person said in the audience, Washington, D.C. sat on that longitudinal line called the Mason-Dixon line, that line on the map that divided the North from the South. And when you crossed the Mason-Dixon, you crossed into those former Confederate states that, during the Jim Crow era, had laws that required the separation of the races on the buses and on the trains. And this was the situation that existed for many years. In fact, it existed just about from the end of Reconstruction to the end of Jim Crow. Black folk had to sit in the rear of the bus, the rear of the train. And you know that story. It wasn't just that we had to sit on the rear of the bus. People would go and pay their bus fare in the front and then have to disboard the train and go to the rear door and get on the train. Many times the train would leave. Sometimes people's hands and legs would get caught in the door and people would be dragged. It was a very humiliating experience. It's one of those things that reminded folk every day of the situation of racial oppression in the United States. And black people couldn't escape it. Whether you were rich or whether you were poor, you were controlled by this system of laws. And recently we lost Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela was the champion of the anti-apartheid movement, the first black president of South Africa. And we said, what a terrible system that was they had in South Africa. But the South Africans learned it from us. The laws of racial segregation, they lifted right from our law books. The system of Bantustans, of herding the people onto these small parcels of land for blacks only in South Africa, they lifted that from the system of Native American reservations in the United States. So when we talk about apartheid, remember we had apartheid here and we had it here first. But then the question is, how did we overthrow this terrible system of racial oppression and racial discrimination and racial control and racial violence? That system was overthrown by courageous people who came from all walks of life, most of whom, their names we don't even know. But they stood up for us. And one of the things that's often overlooked when we think about the freedom struggle is the role that young people played in the freedom struggle. You know, February 1st is the first day of Black History Month, but it also is one of those significant days that talks about the role of youth in the struggle. It was four students from North Carolina A&T that sat in at a Woolworth's lunch counter in Greensboro, North Carolina, and that started the sit-in movement. And within 18 months of that first sit-in, more than 3,000 young people were arrested in protests throughout the South. But there were other people who did not necessarily do it in an organized way, but who said enough was enough. And if it wasn't for those folks, we'd be sitting on the back of the bus today. Imagine that humiliation that generations have been able to escape because of the courage of people like Claudette Colvin, who we are so glad to have in our midst here today. I've been very fortunate in my life. 1971, in one meeting, Dr. King had already been assassinated, so I couldn't meet him, but I had been invited to the Southern Christian Leadership Conference in New Orleans, Louisiana, in the summer of 1971, after I had been appointed to the Board of Education, the youngest school board member in the country at that time. Now, I was going to receive this award, this Youth Leadership Award from SCLC, and in one meeting, I was able to meet Coretta Scott King and Ralph Abernathy and Andrew Young, Jesse Jackson, and sitting in the room, very quietly, she didn't have a big crowd around her, was Rosa Parks. And we all know and honor the memory of the mother of the civil rights movement, Rosa Parks. But at that time, I only knew one part of the story about the struggle in Montgomery. Many of us did not know of the role of Claudette Colvin, that in fact, she was the first person to be arrested in 1955. And she was a young person, only 15 years old. But she had the courage of her convictions. And although the Montgomery bus boycott brought Rosa Parks to national and international prominence, and we remember her memory today, it was Claudette Colvin's case of Browder versus Gale, Aurelia Browder, Claudette Colvin, Mary Louise Smith, and Susie McDonald. Those four, their case is the case that actually went and argued by attorney Fred Gray. It's their case that actually went to the federal district court. And because it was appealed by Mayor Gale of Montgomery, it went to the US Supreme Court. And one of the several lawyers that argued for these women before the US Supreme Court was Thurgood Marshall. And it is because of that case that the United States Supreme Court declared in 1956 that segregated seating on buses and trains was unconstitutional. And what a momentous decision that was, because it was upon the receipt of that decision that Martin Luther King ended the Montgomery bus boycott. So isn't it remarkable that we could have with us today one of the great pioneers that helped to dismantle the system of apartheid in this country? Let us welcome Sister Claudette Colvin.
Stand here before you and share my story. But first, I'd like to thank the committee that invited me here, and Pop and Larry Hamm and whoever was responsible for inviting me here to tell my story. This is, as Larry said, my anniversary, 59 years ago. I don't really know where to begin, but let me begin, as I said, the evening of March the 2nd, 1955. As the story goes, I walked home from school. We must have gotten out early that day, that evening, and we walked downtown from Booker T. Washington School to downtown Montgomery. But it was in the middle of the week, so we didn't browse around down at the 5 and 10. So it was about 13 of us. We boarded the Harlem Gardens bus in, across the street from Dr. King Church on Dexter and Bainbridge. I know some people are familiar with that church. But anyway, it was about 13 students that lived in my community. And so when we boarded the bus, it wasn't full, it wasn't crowded. So we sit where we was allowed to sit. The back, African-American, we was called colored in those days. we sit in a seat where we was allowed, and there was a few whites, passionists there. But as the bus proceeded on down Dexter, it became full of capacity. And so this young white woman was standing near me and in the rear of the bus, near the rear of the bus. And the bus driver asked for the four seats. And three other students got up, reluctantly, and I remained seated. So the problem was, this passioner could have sit opposite me, but the problem is, in Jim Crow South, a white person wasn't supposed to sit across the aisle from a black person. They were supposed to sit in front of a black person. The rule was, in all the transportation system, is that white people sit in front of a black person and black people sit behind that white person. Passioners, that is in order to show that they were superior and we was inferior. So I'm going to answer three questions. One of the questions, reporters, I have told this story so many times. So one of the questions they asked, why didn't I move when the bus driver asked me to get up? And my answer was that I couldn't move because history had me glued to the seat. And one reporter, he said, how is that? Well, I had to go in a long detail because he didn't understand what I was talking about. I said, Negro History, February was Negro History Month. But at that time, we wasn't really legally celebrating for the whole month. It was a Negro History Week. But since we had segregated schooling, the faculty members said that since we were deliberately left out of history, American history, we had to learn, the students, who was all African-American, should know about their heroes. And the only way we could learn it is through that month, that opportunity that we had to discuss our heroes and all the injustice that existed in the system. So we discussed, at that time, the big thing talk was about Jackie Robinson breaking a baseball barrier. So, and then we discussed all the other people who was activists in the fighting for our civil rights. So, my favorite one was Harriet Tubman. And another was Sojourner Truth. These were the women, they was my favorite. And I know some of the students might know about Harriet Tubman with the Underground Railroad. And we were saying, what is the Underground Railroad? There was no railroad. So he said it was called the Underground Railroad because this was the safe houses for the runaway slaves, for the ones that Harriet was leading. They called these safe houses the Underground Railroad. And then we talked about Booker T. Washington, and we talked about George Washington Carver. Now, you know, there was a lot of essays that was going around talking about Booker T. Washington, George Washington Carver, because those were the only two African Americans that was in Britannica at that time. So what was surprising, when I wrote my essay, I talked about the injustice in Montgomery. And so I discussed all the things like we wasn't allowed to try on clothes in the department stores, and that when we go on school excursion, we wasn't allowed to enter the front entrance. We had to enter at the employees' entrance. And they made sure that there was no white students the day that we visited, that day that we had the tour. So, and then we talked about we only, in the entertainment, only when the fair come to town, we only had one day. So, and all the injustice. And then at Booker T. Washington, one of our classmates, one of the students, was on death row for supposed to being a serial rapist. And his name was Jeremiah Rees. So we discussed all the injustice. This double standard existed because when a white man raped a young black woman, nothing was done about it. It didn't even go to the jury. It didn't even make it. They just threw it out. So I talked about all the injustice in my essay. And my instructor, her name was Ms. Geraldine Nesbitt. And so she said, she saw that I was very, very, very strong in my belief as a young student. And so that's why I tell the people, that I told the reporter, that's why history had me glued to the seat, because we had been discussing this and had these discussions in school about our historical heroes. So I told most people, the reporter, I said, do you know how it felt? I was paralyzed in my seat because I was so intrigued about Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman. These was two African American women. I said it felt like Harriet Tubman was pushing me down, hands were pushing me down on one shoulder, and Sojourner Truth were pushing me down on another shoulder. So that's why I could move when the bus driver asked me to get up. So, and then I wasn't breaking the law, the segregation. I wasn't sitting in the white section. But in order to Jim Crow law, the bus driver could ask you to get up. Well, any white person in authority could ask you to do something without really reason, you know, not in keeping with the law. That's why the law is considered, call it Jim Crow, because like they make up their own rules. So anyway, the bus driver, you know, I had time to think, because it proceeded on one stop, two stop, three stops, all the way to Court Square. And that was like a little mini depot, you know, as they had where the buses made their connection going in either direction, north or south. But then the bus driver hailed a traffic patrolman, and the traffic patrolman come on the bus in the back, and he said, gal, why are you sitting there? I said, I paid my fare, and it's my constitutional rights. And so he yelled to the bus driver that he had no jurisdiction here. And so, well, we students thought that was it, you know. So what? If she have a whole, if she don't want to sit down, she has a whole seat there to sit down with this white lady. She has a whole seat to herself, but she couldn't sit there because I was sitting in the opposite aisle on another seat. And I knew that was really unfair. So the bus driver was, I guess, the traffic patrol him. Well, since there was bystanders, they don't want any altercations and no riot here, I guess something he had told him, okay, we'll arrest her a block later. So the bus driver went one block in the same direction of the regular route. And we thought it was over. So we got to Bibb and Karma Street. And that's where two squad car policemen come to the back door, and they came up, and I was even more defiant. And you know what? They said I scratched, I was fighting, pulling, scratching, kicking. I wasn't doing that. And what made them angry is that I was just frozen in my seat. I told you I was paralyzed in my seat. I couldn't move because Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman had been pushing me down. So I couldn't move. And because I refused to walk off voluntarily, one grabbed one arm by the arm and the other grabbed the other arm. And I don't know how I got off the bus. So somebody said they drove me off, dragged me off backwards, and one was, you know, taking turns and dragging me off, because I was about a size 6 then. So anyway, I do remember being put in the patrol car and sticking my arm, they asked me, putting my arms out the window, and they put handcuffs on me. And I was taken to City Hall and was booked, and the policemen there were saying all kind of obscenity and, you know, bad things about black girls. And they said, they were trying to guess my bra size. Yes, then one said, well, we're gonna get rid of this black bitch. We're gonna send her to an admiral. And I know they were just saying that to frighten me, because that is for adult women. That wasn't for juveniles. I knew I had sense enough to know I wasn't going to Admiral. So anyway, they booked me and they took me to an adult jail. So then, oh my God. So I was like I was cast into hell. I don't know, you children watch these old westerns where they have the jail and you hear the keys go click when they close. They was not electronic like today. The keys go click and they lock me in, and then the panic came over me. And you know, I'm Baptist. And Lord, I started praying. I started saying the 23rd Psalm. And I recited every Bible verse I knew. And then, to keep myself going, we were studying Edgar Allan Poe, and I started reciting some of Edgar Allan Poe's poems. And you know, mostly Edgar Allan Poe's poems, and most of his stuff is really dreary, weird, really dreary, you know? So anyway, I was crying, and I wanted to know whether mom was going to, the student was going to tell my mother, or whether they was going to just run home and talk about it amongst themselves. But at least they did come home and tell my parents. And my mother came, and my pastor, Reverend H.H. Johnson, came and bailed me out. I stayed in the jail approximately about 3 hours. So anyway, As Reverend Johnson was driving over this, I don't know if you're familiar with the South, but in the Old South, there's the railroad track here and the highway here, and there's a little hump. And so, like, you go over the hump and you can hear them sing, you know, the Indians singing. And Reverend Johnson said, "Well, Claudette, I think you done brought the revolution in here." I got home, and my dad said, "Oh, Claudette," oh, he was so worried about me. He said, "But baby, you don't brought put us in a lot of danger." And you know, there's no, he didn't say danger, because in the South, we don't have an R. We forget about the R. A lot of danger. So I said, "Oh my God, Dad." And my dad just got his shells and loaded his shotgun and sit there. He said, "Well, they, the KK ain't gonna take you out here tonight." We see where I live. I think the reporters called that where we live is the reporters, the northern reporters. "Oh, well, that was the wasteland from the white community, and the white community in the front and the white community in the back. So we lived on this little elevated land left over called King Hill. It was called, they called, the white people called it Villas Heights, but we renamed it because we knew that they deliberately left it out because they didn't put in indoor plumbing and they didn't pave the street. But yet it's still, that wasn't gonna let us down. We called ourselves King Hill. Because we were looking down over all of them." Yes. So anyway, the people that lived on the highway, he said the Dixon line, my tongue getting a little dry. Let me get some water. The highway on the right side, or depending on which way you're going, on one side the white people was the white community, on the other side was this elevated black hill called King Hill, that's what we'll call the black community. But you could see if the KKK come, because there's only one way in and one way out. So all the King Hills that night stayed up looking for the KKK. But because we knew it was going to be some repercussion for my action. And then to see the 13 students on the bus, they didn't get up and walk off one by one. See, it was like all of us acting together. So anyway, but I want to let you know, it was an impulsive act. None of us had planned it. It was impulsive. But we had all our young lives of this unfair treatment, and we had such good instructors doing, they was like ministers trying to convert you to religion on February. So we had all that instilling us. So that's why, you know, and that was a pillar of support for me too. So anyway, we stayed up all night and everything went down. And later on during the year, another girl was arrested. Her name was Mary Louise Smith. Well, she was arrested in October, but she kept a low profile, and she just, you know, her father got her out and paid her fine. And then I joined they asked me to come and talk to Mrs. Parks through E.D. Nixon was the one who told me to go and talk with Rosa Parks and share my story with her youth group. And so I went to talk with Ms. Parks, and Ms. Parks, her family, but she, I don't think she mentioned it too much. You probably read it in her autobiography. She once lived in Pine Level from the same community that I lived in until I was 8 years old. But my parents knew Mrs. Parks. But you know how people were moving in those days. They were leaving the rural South, going to the cities. So they lost connection. So when I went there, I visited Mrs. Parks, She said, "You know, Claudette, when I first heard the story," she said, "I thought that you was an overgrown teenager that liked to sass white folks. But when I talked to your teachers," she said, "then I realized you was intellectually mature enough to know right from wrong and your civil rights." So I said, so I was so thankful. And so she, Mrs. Parks, helped me raise money funds for my attorney. She did. I ran for Miss NAACP, you know, I didn't win, I won second place. But anyway, going on to tell you the story, since it is my anniversary, I just want to tell you some important things. I know you read in the book that the reason why I was rejected, why Mary Louise Smith Ware, and I was rejected. I was rejected because I was an unwed mother, and Mary Louise Smith Ware was rejected because her father was an alcoholic. That was in Taylor Branch, Part in the Water. But the fact is, I was not pregnant March the 2nd. And so anyway, and Mary Louise Smith Ware's father wasn't an alcoholic. He just like everybody else, you know, didn't have air conditioning, shoot the breeze under a shade tree. Yeah, that's it. So, but anyway, and Mrs. Susan McDonald, she was fairer than Mrs. Parks. The bus driver get an altercation with her, and she, you know, used profanity. And so she got angry at Miss Susan McDonald because she wouldn't let the white patron that sit next to her know that she wasn't colored, that she was white. They thought that Mrs. Susan McDonald, the white passioner, thought that Mrs. Susan McDonald was white. And the bus driver got angry at Mrs. Susan McDonald because she wouldn't let the white people know that she had colored blood in her. And Mrs. Aurelia Browder, several times, she had an altercation, and she called a man, Mrs. Browder mouth was like this. So they picked her. So he, Attorney Fred Gray, had to go back to all the people he had rejected. He had to come back because he wanted the men to take, Attorney Fred Gray and the MIA wanted the men to take leadership in taking the case to the Supreme Court. But what happened? They was afraid, the men was afraid, because that church was, the KK was active, and he went especially to the ministers. So the KK was active, and they was bombing their churches. So the men was afraid. So they had to come back to the people, the teenager who had a child out of wedlock, and they had to come back to the girl whose father was an alcoholic, and the two women's whose mouth were too big. So that's why they had to use the four women. And they was advised by other attorneys that they couldn't, they had prepped Mrs. Parks because she was the typical woman and the iconic figure there in Montgomery because she was the secretary of the NAACP, the adult NAACP branch. So they wanted Mrs. Parks, but Mrs. Parks was arrested, and Mrs. Parks being mild-mannered, you know, she was only arrested for disorderly conduct. And so they said they did not know whether all the citizens in Montgomery would be willing to stay off the bus another year. So they advised Robert Carter and Thurgood Marshall and all, it wasn't just one attorney. They saw that Dr. King was so great, such a great leader, and it was just like a miracle that he had held these Negroes together for all this long. They didn't want him to lose the case because they had two other cases that was in Tallahassee and Baton Rouge that was a failure. They had stayed off, but it was a failure. So they didn't want him to lose. So they said, in order not to lose this case, Attorney Fred Gray, we advise you to find the four other plaintiffs right away. So they had to come back to the rejects. So, so anyway, you don't really know. That day, particular day, I did not know that I was going to make history because I had told the student I wasn't going to Alabama State when I graduated from high school. I was going north to study how to free my people like Harriet Tubman. So I'm so glad that we had all these brilliant lawyers and attorneys got together and made it a success. See, I'm really disappointed that they don't come out and tell exactly how it went down. There's no, because the youth today, the second question asked by the youth, when I do my little presentation, about the same amount, or maybe 200 people or 100 people or more, they ask me, I think the civil rights movement was a failure. I said, it was not a failure. The reason why I know it was not a failure, but you have to be old enough to know what we accomplished and what went undone. And before I close, another question they asked, I told you it was three, right? So the last one they want to ask me was, now, especially from white audience, how do you feel that, you know what I'm going to say. How do you feel that President Obama is president, the first African-American president? I tell them this. Oh, my friend is not here. He was, he done crossed over. You know who I'm talking about. I have ambivalent feelings about President Barack Obama. I said, like everyone else that evening, that inauguration evening, I was jumping up just like I had just got religion. You know, Baptist people, when they just get religion, they got to shout. So I was jumping up. Thank God. Oh, Jesus. Thank God. Thank you, Jesus. And now that he'd been in and was reelected, I said, well, they put so much on Barack Obama's table. I said, Obama, present to me, this is my opinion now. And I don't have no statistics to prove it. This is just my opinion. I think President Obama is smart enough. He is just like you do, like the garment people do, fabric, right? You just tailor one size fit all. He put all our grievances and everything in one size fit all. That means he's president and just whatever he says, just one size fit all. One thing go for all, everyone. But we know we African Americans, we are so far behind in this economic system that we need a little boost, we need a little help. But that's why I said that he has tailored everything so that he doesn't have any, is less controversial against the African-American community. I know he's not only the president for African-American community of people, but I wish you would go out with one good thing, say, to help us. Because, for instance, is no reason why we should have losing all our boys to the criminal justice system. That's why we had integration, trying to fight inadequate school system. So we should have better schools. And small businessmen, we should have more representatives of black entrepreneurs. So but if you're going to go out and help foreigner people solve their problem, why don't you start here, President Obama? That's why, my friend, can you say his name?
Evanifa.
Yeah. Evanifa, I'm not using any profanity. But anyway, I love Obama. Don't forget that I love him. But yet still, we need him to put a word in before he go out of office. Because we don't know what we know what we have, but we do not know what we're getting in 16. And I don't know how, but I just wanted to say this and thank God that I can tell my story. And if you young people, you don't have to feel inferior. You have a brain. You can go out there and be anything, you know. If you get support and it is a shame, you can reach your full potential if you have the support. I know you have the mind. But anyway, I want the young people to know that the civil rights movement wasn't a total failure. We have broken down a lot of barriers. But elderly people have to pass the torch on to you. And you got to keep getting up, and it's not going to be easy if you color, you know, whether you're Latino or African-American, if you're a minority, it's not going to be easy. And you got to have support from your parents and your community. So before I close, I was saying this because I'm 74. I have reached my, what the Bible said, 70? Plus, I got four more years. But anyway, young people, we are not where we want to be collectively as African Americans, but thank God Almighty, we not where we were.
Thank you, Claudette Colvin. We know we can't keep you here forever, but I could listen to you for another hour. Yeah. Good sound advice. She's a passionate, smart woman that I thought she would be. And once again, I'm grateful to you for what you did. Ms. Colvin is willing to take some questions. If you ask a question, I've told her she can sit, and I will just hand her the mic when she gives her answer. I can't hand her the mic. This is a recording mic. I can't move it. Oh, it's the one here. Oh, all right. I'm sorry. You're going to have to stand, okay. Do we have any questions? Yes.
I only met Dr. King once at a dinner party, but I met him several times at the back, you know, when he showed his face at the bathroom. He wasn't there every meeting, but I was a teenager. I couldn't get close to Dr. King. He was like God to the speaker. I couldn't get close to Dr. King. But at a dinner party at Reverend Abernathy's house, he was sitting by the kitchen window.
So picture with him, and he was sitting in his seat by the picture with him. He got up and he said, "Lord, for me, I was eating ice cream." And he said, "Claudette, you are a brand young woman." That's what he said. I said, "Thank you, Lord."
Wow.
Are you going to be able to pick up okay if we use this mic? Yes? Okay. Okay, another question? Yes, sir.
She had suggested that they had to go back to the rejected. Who were the rejected?
Who were the rejected?
I'm sorry, you can just...
She stated that they had to go back to the rejected. Who were the rejected?
Did you understand the question?
She said, "Who was rejected? Rejected was me, who was had a child out of wedlock, and Mary Lee Smith Ware, whose father was supposed to be an alcoholic." This is documented in Party One by Taylor Branch, and this is Susan McDonald, and this is Amelia Brown. Miles was too mousy. See, they put out, Dr. King wanted, I'm sorry, not Dr. King, Attorney Fred Gray went to the ministers first. But they, because they find that their ministry would not interfere with that economy. I'm going to say that now, they were ministers. But they was afraid because that church was bombed by the KKK. And the reason why they had to come back to the rejects was because the time was running out. See, he filed a case February 2nd, 1956. He had a lot of little litigation went down. And see, Attorney Fred Gray was not the only attorney. It was several attorneys on that case. On the case, I did not know that, And one of the main attorneys was Robert Carter. And third was Martin. They said since Dr. King had made such a helped the African Americans together for all of this for the whole year, they didn't want to lose the case. That's why.
Thank you. Do you want her to move over in this chair? Can we move you over to the chair so they can see you as you're answering?
Around with the Mustang and he got killed.
What did you say? I didn't understand you.
The kid who was playing, they say he was fooling around like sitting in front of the bus or something like that, and they killed him.
I didn't say that.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Two questions. Ms. Nesbitt was very important when you were in school. When's the last time that you talked to her or saw her? And then is there anything that you'd like to tell us about Raymond?
Mrs. Nesbitt passed away. The only thing, she graduated from Columbia. She got a master's from Columbia. And she was what the faculty called an unorthodox teacher. You know, Ms. Nesbitt asked you to use Ebonics, and we don't. She didn't say Ebonics, but we wouldn't say Ebonics at that. She said use your own language, and she refused to teach grammar because she said if I had to teach grammar, I got to get them at 2 years old.
Yes, sir.
No,
I think after the 25th anniversary, I I think Attorney Fred Gray should have said it. I think Attorney Fred Gray should have said that because Mrs. Parks was the spokeswoman for the bus boycott, she was not used in the case that went to the Supreme Court. That's the most important thing. And that it was, well, most everyone knew that I was, they stand for themselves, speak for themselves. I think the Attorney Fred Gray should have mentioned it.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, my name is Courtney Hale, and I'd like to commend all your efforts. And thank you for being so strong, because that's what we need. More people are willing to stand up and recognize that we do have civil rights. And with that thought being said, I'd like to know your feelings about today's civil rights movement and how it can become stronger and where people can become more unified in their determination to fight injustice. Mm-hmm. But it seems like we're going backwards in employment, in housing, in our rights, generally speaking. And even 27-year-old people are saying this now, and it's very clear that lack of respect for us is blatant. And sometimes we also harm ourselves. We need to stop.
Okay? Well, that is a very complicated problem we have. That's why I was saying that President Obama has tailored all our grievances as into one size fit all. And what I guess symbolically what I meant is that think that one thing can take care of all our grievances. But as far as I'm concerned, this is a capitalistic society. And if you, what Pop is doing, you have to organize at a community level. And then not only as a community level, you got to start parenting, because something is going down if the mind of a 12-year-old say, well, I'm going to deliver this package and get money for it. I'm not going to flip burgers at Burger King or McDonald's. They want to take the short way out. So they should have the wisdom, the young, older people should do better parenting. And that's the only thing that will bring us together, is you got to start with the parents. Reason why I say that, I'm talking from experience. I was a single mom, and you know what it took to get my children through? It was my family. I can be a proud mother, and I'm sitting in this church, and I thank you, Jesus. I have one grandson who is a medical doctor. I have one granddaughter who's an RN. I have another granddaughter right now, bless her little heart, she's in Africa. Study. And I have another two more. One is in Washington, D.C. He was in the military. He was in Washington, D.C. now. He's not active now. He's in Washington, D.C., head of security in one of the office buildings in Washington, D.C. And I have another grandson. He's in Arizona. He's in the Air Force. So I tell my grandchildren, that, and I told my son too, I said, in this world, it's not our design, this world that we live in. I said, it's designed by Europeans. And I said, you have to have two heads. And he said, Grandpa, what is two heads? Sound like, science fiction thing, right? I said, you know what I mean? I said, you got to have two minds. One, to understand European people, or what we call white folks, and the other one is to stay focused or stay grounded. If you do that, you'll get over. And I said, maybe one day if we have enough elected officials, we can design our own community and try to create better laws. So that's the only thing we're going to do, is to work together in the community.
Young woman that you were,
did any of them ever? No, because my parents, my mother and father, they took Southern African American people. They said, girls, hold your head up high. And I didn't look like any of them, and I didn't go to them, so I cannot answer. I don't know. They never come to me, and they never came to me. All they said was, girl, you brave and crazy. My parents never did change it. You know that in the rural South, I mean Alabama and Birmingham, well, all the southern states. I don't know all the southern cities, and I know all my classmates. And the reason why I said it, one of my friends had to go and get her name corrected when she got her marriage license, because But if you're not, my birth certificate name is still Austin. I was never legally adopted, but in the South, if someone raised you from 18 months, you automatically take that name. So I was raised by my great aunt and her husband, and I was with them from 18 months. So I'm automatically is a Colvin. I don't know, you asked that, but since I never was married, I don't know how that would. How that would go? I would have to. That's a very good question. Oh, well, I got two lovers. One is, my first love is Dr. King, and my second love is Malcolm X. And Kool-Aid.
you sit down and you have a discussion, you know, and you know, like, and today, you know, parents are so interested in how you look. They tell you got to have, first thing, if you a minority, you want to get a good education. And do the teachers, do they discuss the teachers? Are the teachers really motivating them? Are they very good leaders? Are they just there, just killing time? So you have to get involved in their school. That's the only thing that I can say. Get involved in the school. Better be a start.
There was discussion yesterday about not having it. I'm glad that we went ahead.
Yes.
Because I think we all learned something this afternoon. And I feel elevated by being in the presence of Ms. Colvin, and hopefully you do as well. And just a personal reminder that I think is a take on the last question that was asked. And I have members, I teach an adult Sunday school class, and there are members from that class that are here today and know that we had a discussion this morning.
And one of the points that we talked about was our generation failing generations under us because we may have tried to teach them to be successful, to go to school and to study. But what we did not do successfully is to say you have to be successful and you lift others as you climb. That whatever knowledge you have, whatever finances you have a responsibility to share with other people in your community. And I think that that comment was appropriate. That's where we went wrong. So I encourage all of you to not just lift as you climb, but to spread that word to others as well. Now, in that same spirit, you're here, it's warm, the lights are on. Mr. Hamm used his gas to go and pick up Ms. Colvin. You have literature that he's distributing. None of that comes from the air. It's all paid for. There are some realities about life, and that's called bills. So we are having a free will offering as you leave this sanctuary today. I ask you to consider being generous. Hopefully you believe in the work that POP is doing, and you believe in the work that this church is trying to do as well. Because not only are we Baptists, but we're political activists. And I always like to say that Bethany is a verb, it's not a noun. We're an active church, and we're active in our community. So we need your help to stay that way. I see a few Jazz Vespers people here. You know, the lights just don't turn on. We have that PSE&G bill as well. All right? So thank you very much, Mr. Hamm. Okay. Who, I'm feeling old because I remember him on city council when he was a kid.
My main reason for returning to make some remarks, because Ms. Epps really said it all, was to say thank you to Bethany Baptist Church for letting us have this program here today. And wasn't Claudette Colvin great? Give her another hand. And the free will offering that we're taking will also include an honorarium. I think Ms. Colvin is deserving of it. We should give her a little something to take home to make her life a little bit easier. And I want to give a big round of applause to the Bethany Baptist Church Book Club for being the co-sponsor of today's program. Thank you, Ms. Epps and members of the book club. And my sister handed me, I didn't even know about this, but my sister handed me a leaflet that Ms. Colvin will be at the Newark Public Library on Wednesday, March 5th. You didn't tell me that on the way over here. Wednesday, March 5th at 6:30 p.m. So if those of you didn't get your... Oh, it's canceled? Are you sure? Oh, it's canceled. Oh, I'm sorry. Somebody gave me a leaflet. I was just trying to do my job. The person who gave me the leaflet, is it on or off? Is it on or off? Oh, it's rescheduled. Okay, all right. So it's, do you have the new date? Do you have the new date? Do you have the new date? She doesn't have it yet. Thank you. Okay. Let me also announce that the People's Organization for Progress, we're trying to bring other heroes and heroines from the civil rights movement. How many of you know about the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church? Yes. This year, 2014, is the 50th anniversary of the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. One of the primary reasons that the Civil Rights Act was passed by Congress was because of the sympathetic environment that was created after the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church and the murder of those four little girls. Now, one of the girls that died in the 16th Street Baptist Church was Addie Mae Collins. There were four who were killed, but there were about 15 others that were injured. One of those was her sister, Sarah, that was at the church that day. People's Organization for Progress will be bringing Sarah Rudolph Collins here on the 27th of March. She's coming to Abyssinian Baptist Church on March 27th, so everyone is invited to that. It will be at 6:30. On March 27th, Thursday, March 27th, at the Abyssinian Baptist Church, Sarah Collins lost her sight as a result of the bombing, but she regained sight in one eye. So we are flying her and her husband up here to be with us on the 27th, so we hope everybody will spread the word and come out to hear her story. And then we are returning to Bethany on April 2nd, and co-sponsoring with the Board of Deacons, Dr. Cornell West. He will be here on April the 2nd. I believe that is a Wednesday night, and that program will be at 6:30 p.m. also on Wednesday, April 2nd. So I invite you to come to both of those programs, and I would also like to invite everyone here to join the People's Organization for Progress. We are a grassroots organization. We are all volunteer organization. We work for racial, social, economic justice, and peace. Even if you're a member of other organizations, you can be a member of POP. I'm a member of two chapters of the NAACP, but I'm also the chairman of the People's Organization for Progress, and I believe the membership forms are outside. Cliff, is that right? Yeah, yes, the membership forms out there? Yes, okay. So I invite people to join POP. And lastly, let me just say thank you to your pastor, the great pastor of this church, Reverend William Howard. A great pastor. He has been my friend. I met Reverend Howard in 1977 when he was at the Princeton Theological Seminary. And I was an undergraduate student at Princeton University, and we were both engaged in the anti-apartheid movement on Princeton's campus and around the world. And we have been close friends ever since. And I just thought the hand of Providence had to be in him becoming a pastor here in Newark, New Jersey, so that we could continue our work together. So again, thank you. The People's Organization for Progress, we meet every Thursday. We meet every Thursday at the Abyssinian Baptist Church, 224 West Kenny Street, every Thursday at 6:30. Our meetings are open to the general public. Everyone here is invited to attend. Ms. Epps.
I meant to say this in my remarks, I forgot. Bethany Baptist Church is sponsoring a civil rights tour. This summer we're going to Birmingham.
All right.
Charleston, Savannah, Greensboro, Selma. I'm forgetting. I can't remember all, but it's a 10-day bus civil rights tour. If you're interested, look on the church's website to get information. Call the church, or you can call me to get information. Thank you.
Yes. So everybody, I thank you for coming out. Obviously, it was meant for us to be here today. The storm seemed to hold back that they were talking about. And everything just worked out so well today. And once again, Sister Claudette Colvin, thank you for all that you did for our people. And we will not let it be forgotten. I promise you. All right. And everybody, please make a generous donation on your way out the door. Thank you very much. Yes? How do you get your book? Go to Amazon. Amazon, Barnes & Noble, yes. All right. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming.